Hello everyone, hi, welcome to the channel of Wall Street Mojo. Friends, today we are going to learn a topic that is the top 10 economic indicators, what exactly to look into and why. So let's get started. The top 10 economic indicators. See, even before getting into the content above, this topic is basically subjective, not to mention that it could be fairly little bit misleading. Now it's okay, we can start with this. The first and the foremost thing that we can study, the first indicator that you should go for is the GDP and the GDP growth rates. So you can say there is a lagging indicator generally. They are fundamental factor to look at. Look at the finance news for the same, and you would notice that the IMF or some other institution has revised their GDP growth rate. Forecast of a country, GDP or gross domestic product is the monetary value of the goods and service produced in the country. The second indicator that you should go look into is, you can say the debt and basically their ratios, you can say, and the cycles. So debt ratios, debt cycles, and so on and so forth. So this is leading indicator. We can say that this is leading indicator, a fairly large topic in itself, but very important. Debt is essentially borrowing money and comes into two forms. One is the private debt, debt issued by the corporates and other institutions, loans taken by individual groups of the individuals. And there is called a public debt, borrowing by governments. So the money borrowed can be used in many ways depending upon who is issuing it. Very important. This money borrowed can be used in many ways depending upon who is actually issuing the debt, to finance asset purchases and to pay equity holders to the fund projects and to take levered risk on the trades. And when there is more borrowing than the ability to pay down the dues, then that's a different case. So thus there is a limit to how much debt can or should be taken. Other ways in which debt can be taken is either domestically or from abroad. Now, the third indicator that you can ponder into is the inflation and inflation expectation. Okay, that's the third thing you should go into. Now, while you may think that there isn't much explanation to do about inflation as you already know it, but it could be mistaken. Inflation takes different forms to me as a vague indicator, which I wouldn't like to delve into, but it has been and will be really be important one for the economists, the economy and the policymakers, investors and the trade alike. So apart from the various types of the inflation, the metric commonly used are like CPI. They also use like WPI, that is the wholesale price index. Then they have the PCE, that is the personal consumption expenditure, and GDP deflator. So in general, excessive inflation can cause a fall into exchange rates, high interest rates to curb it, and demand and supply side issue and blowing up to the prices, economic terrorism, where everyone is basically a hostage. Now, fourth, what you should look into is the exchange rate. Okay, exchange rate stability is the fourth thing that you should go for. The word stability is very important over here. Exchange rate in general compared with the US dollar, it tells us how much one unit of the US dollar would fetch in terms of the domestic currency. Like let's say for example, India's exchange rate is 67 per US dollar. Within the exchange rate, there are two areas where you must focus on. First thing is the nominal effective exchange rate, that is NEER, which adjusts the exchange rate weighted according to the trade in other countries. And then is another thing that's called REER. So there are two things. NEER and REER. REER means real effective exchange rate, which adjusts the exchange rate comparing it with the basket of the other currencies adjusted for inflation. And that's enough to know about right now. Now you can say that the fifth indicator that we'll ponder into is the interest rates. Now why this is important? See, of late, the 10-year benchmark, interest rate bonds of Germany, Switzerland, Japan, and few other countries have been yielding negative interest rates. You lend money and get paid back less when the amount is due. Crazy enough, right? But that's the world we live in. Negative policy rates in countries suggest poor economies, and very low to negative 10-year bond rate can indicate a heavy safe haven investments or possible recession. So if treasury yield curve is downward sloping. So during this financial crisis of 2008, we have known about the credit spread. I'll write for you, credit spread blew over the roof and caused the corporate distress and defaults. The sixth indicator is basically the gold prices and other metal prices, right? Gold is considered as a safe haven asset and tends to go up in the value if there is a recession-like tendency in the world economy, just like prices of US and German T-bonds. Although there are deeper facets to understand in gold price movements, other precious metals like silver and platinum prices also must be looked into to confirm our take on gold. Now, why they are? See, in close enough to in 2015, or gold prices had almost touched close enough to $1,050 ounce, and the changing critical complexion of the world from moderately safe to risky caused heavy allocation of money in gold, and it currently trades in the range of $1,350. So that's a pretty interesting thing. The seventh indicator that you should ponder into is the stock markets and volatility. You can say stock markets and volatility. Now, a leading indicator, they are basically the first thing that comes to our attention in the morning if you have got into money at stake. It reflects the sentiments of the investors and traders alike on the companies that form the stock index and macro decisions that affects their sentiments. So volatility is the risk we see due to the large fluctuations on either side of the index, but it's tilted more to the downside. Market volatility is measured in the volatility index. The next thing that you should go for is the risk premiums. This is really important. Risk premiums are generally lagging indicators and give you a sense of the perceived riskiness of the different security and index. Simply put, they are like extra, you can say, expected return that you get for facing the volatility. It's like RP, your risk from the market minus the risk from the risk-free rate, that is your risk premium. So when coupled with slow growth and other slowdowns, this could actually affect the country's credit rating given by the credit rating agencies like S&P and Moody's. Now, why exactly risk premiums are there? See, during the credit crisis of 2008, credit spreads blew over the roof below, like, you know, you can understand that CDS premiums around 2008 crisis were like crazy. It had gone way beyond the mark that one could even imagine. So that's why risk premium has an utmost importance. Then the next thing that you should look into is the budgets, deficit and surpluses in FDI flows. FDI flow also plays a very important role. Then there is deficits and surplus. That's basically, you can see, the balance of payment and balance deficit. A good government that takes progressive steps and tries to achieve its budgetary targets are generally rewarded, and what follows is like good stock market performance, possible FDI and a better credit rating, etc. So higher deficit has to be financed and is generally done by issuing government debt, thereby raising money. So this again gets linked into the debt spiral and weakening the exchange rates. So a surplus would reduce the debt, but may reduce the incentive to push reforms ahead given in that economy seemingly looks strong. So strong and consistent FDI are an ambiguous good, while weakness would indicate a drop in the bullish sentiments. The last thing that you should look into is the crude oil prices. Now, this has become even more important since crude oil fell from around 120 barrel to 50 barrel in 2015. This is like the most important thing nowadays. Then less to 25 barrel in 2016. If you weren't aware of it. So here, you know, basically you need to look into how the prices are getting dropped. Crude oil is a major component which tends to affect the crude importing economies and energy related industry positively when its price falls if they are in net importers, or negatively if they are net exporters. So let me finally conclude on the whole topic. We have possibly covered the whole gamut of economic indicators to give importance in every single heading. Technically, there are easily more than 10 economic indicators mentioned, but keep in mind that political factors is equally important and to be coupled with the economic ones. So the most important economic indicators to choose from the above 10, combining all of them to come up with your independent stance, is the best and the most important of all. Good luck working on that.